All right, let's go into our second big story. Mm-hmm. The Minister of State for Petroleum Resources, Ibe Kachiku, is pushing for the fixing of Nigeria's refineries before 2019.
And that's the year businessman Aliko Dangote's refinery is expected to come on stream. Kachiku believes that the completion of the private refinery would turn those of Nigeria to scraps. He told a conference of experts in Abuja that the only way to prevent that was to fix the refineries in Port Harcourt, Kaduna and Warri.
All right, right now, you see, there are calls for the sale of Nigerian refineries. Mm-hmm. And it's getting louder and louder. It's getting louder, but a lot of people are not happy about it. They're saying, no, this is our heritage. In fact, they use the word heritage, and it shouldn't be sold.
Well, some would say if this heritage would not work, just sell it, or at least concession it or something, because it's become something that was supposed to be an asset. You know, many experts, are saying, look, it's become a liability for us. Mm. And how are we going to continue to spend so much money on turnaround maintenance? Billions and billions have been spent over the years.
The irony of it is some African countries who are not oil producers have set up refineries and they are working.
And countries who only just discovered oil recently, countries like Niger, Ghana, they already have refineries.
All right, joining us now to discuss the future of Nigerian refineries is oil and gas expert Bala Zakka. It's good to have you join us. Good morning.
Thank you.
Bala, you look wonderful. It's good to have you.
Thank you.
And the red tie is intimidating.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us.
All right, let's get into the issue right now. There's so much about when you mention the refineries working or not working in Nigeria, a lot of people have a lot to say. But I've heard a lot of people say that our refineries, as we have them in Kaduna, Warri and
Port Harcourt,
are our national heritage. They shouldn't be sold, whether they work or they don't work.
Nobody will tell you not to do away with something that is not working. But we have to come out and be very open and honest to ourselves as Nigerians. If our refineries are not working, then that means Nigeria is not working. Let us look at things from the historical perspective. I'm somebody who I'm not taking sides, but in the course of these discussions, you will see where my side of the pendulum will swing to. We had the first refinery in 1965, right? Mm-hmm. That was the Port Harcourt refinery, with 60,000 barrels per day nameplate capacity. In 1978, right, we had the Warri refinery, right, with about 110,000 barrels per day capacity. Then in 1980, we had the Kaduna refinery, right, with about 125 barrels per day capacity. Follow me, Nigerians. Mm-hmm. Then in 1989, though the refinery, the second Port Harcourt refinery was constructed in 1988, but was commissioned in 1989 with 150 barrels per day capacity. So from 1965 to 1989, you're talking about 25 years. Yeah. We were able to construct four refineries that are functional or were functional with a total capacity of about 445,000 barrels per day. But look at it now. For all those who are talking anyhow, saying sell, 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 from 1990 to today, 2016, 26 years, we have not been able to construct one additional refinery. We have not been able to maintain the four refineries that were constructed in 25 years between 1965 and 1989. that tells you that something is wrong with the present generation of Nigerians. Whether they are leaders, whether they are media people, whether they are people like Bala Zakka. Because we're talking about a situation where from 1990 to now, we have had more castes.
So what exactly? What exactly?
We have had more politicians. We have had more generals. We have had more money.
Okay.
So it is something that is wrong with Nigerians, all especially right. those who are saying we should do away with these refineries.
That's okay.
All right. We will take a very quick break and return at the top of the hour. It will be time for the news update. There's more on the show. Stay with us.
All right, thanks for joining us on TVC Breakfast. If you're just joining us, we're looking at the refineries in Nigeria and the call for the sale of refineries, what the future of refineries in Nigeria will be. And that's what we're discussing right now. We have Bala Zakka with us, an oil and gas expert. He's been taking us on a journey this morning. Now, before we give our viewers some background information about all of this, you took our minds on a journey earlier on.
Correct.
And as we move ahead now, let me go maybe a little, let me project a little bit. We have especially the Dangote refinery is coming upstream very soon, in about 2 years. When these comes up, and then we're looking forward to other refineries as well, when all these come upstream, what will be the place of the conventional refineries that Nigeria has?
You see, it's always good to appreciate private initiatives, you understand? But national initiative is more important. It is national initiative and national institutions that carry countries along. You can be disappointed by private corporations, by private initiatives anytime because you don't own them. You don't have control over them. Private initiatives are different from what? From national initiatives. That's something we need to understand. It's just like before now, you hear people saying, we need portfolio investors. We need portfolio investors instead of talking about institutional investors. When we went into this recession, you could see what, when we're about to go into recession, you could see what portfolio investors did to Nigeria. They simply took out their investment and left us in the cold. But if you had been romancing, if you have been fraternizing, if you have been cross-fertilizing, if you have been having responsibility accounting with institutional investors, people who have been there when Nigeria had independence, they invested so much. If you have respected them, if you have respected the joint venture relationship between those you yourself and those people, those are the people or investors that will be with you in the days of pains. So, private initiative is something that you can we can commend, but national initiative should be the most important
thing. But there are those who would argue and say, look, government has handled the, you know, this refining business for so long, and that's why we are where we are, that you have three or four refineries not working. And so it's a good argument for, you know, a private sector led, you know, refinery business.
That is the biggest mistake anybody can do when you're talking about an emerging economy. Whether you accept it or not, Nigeria is an emerging economy. Nigeria is still a third world country. When you're talking about emerging economies, you don't talk about imperialism. You don't talk about capitalism. You talk about protectionism. You protect your fragile economy.
But that's the ideal situation. The government, governments over the years have not even, you know, carried out this protectionism policy.
So if they don't, then at some point, you know, you got to a point where failure came in. You should correct the failures. But if you don't correct the failures and you say you are going to expose a fragile economy, a weak economy, a benign and probably a malignant economy
some
like
would
Nigeria,
even say non-economy.
One day all of us will be thrown into captivity, whether you accept it or not. And this thing you're saying has already, in fact, we don't want to be insultive to our government. If not, if you say before you had railways, railways have all failed. You had schools. Schools have failed. You have refineries. Refineries have failed. You have telecommunications. Telecommunications have failed. Virtually everything has failed. You have no right to say the only thing you can do is to have a government or governance in place. Then everything should be privatized because virtually everything has failed. But now back to our real discussion, the refineries. You see, this is everywhere. This is how economics work. Nigeria must not go against gravity. Gravity has principles. Mm. The world is ruled and governed by principles, whether you accept it or not. This world, forget about God. I've never seen God. You can talk about nature, but the world is ruled and governed based on principles. And if you go off the principles, you are going to crash politically, socially, and economically.
And those principles seem to be what we have not been able to define and exactly put in place in such a way that the systems, whatever systems we put in place, would actually work.
Now, looking at those refineries, for example,
talking about the privatization of refineries, which, you know, many people have been calling for, under the last administration, the BPE actually said that the refineries cannot be privatized if, you know, the petroleum industry bill is not passed. What's that got to do with...
Petroleum industry bill is another thing whose non-passage has dented our image, has rubbished us, and I'm telling you, has reduced us to a melancholy country, has only made us to look like a country of great people, great nation, but a very bad example and a bad model. No matter how great you think you are, if you cannot be a model, then I'm telling you, everything about you is sorry. But like, again, back on track, you see, this is how economies are grown everywhere. If a country discovers a resource, especially a natural endowment, the first thing you do is you come up with likely institutions that will help you in what? Research and development that will make you explore the natural resource. Once you do that, then the next thing is you come up with facilities, whether you call them factories or whatever, that will help you process these facilities. So when oil was first discovered in Nigeria, right, what our founding fathers did, they were visionary. You don't expect them. They didn't have the brains we have. They didn't have the computers. They didn't have the internet. But in those days, the first thing they did was to come up with likely institutions to do something about oil and gas. Even before Nigeria became a member of OPEC, there was a prerequisite. You must establish an institution. And that was how Petroleum Training Institute, PTI Wari, was established. You know, as a prerequisite to Nigeria being a member of OPEC. Then before we knew what was happening, we started having institutions and universities teaching courses in what? Oil and gas engineering or petroleum engineering. Then our founding fathers, what did they do next? They started what? Constructing the refineries. That is how you do. When you construct, the essence is to process that raw material into finished goods. That is what everybody does. You don't export. You start by process so that you take advantage of all the benefits.
But there was a time in this same country when all these refineries worked optimally, that Nigeria was not importing even 1 liter of
and
petroleum.
And what was
products.
Our GDP? Right. We were a great country.
Bala, we'll come back to this shortly. Let's go on a break and then we come to dwell on this more. Thank you. All right, if you're just joining us, you're watching TVC Breakfast and we're looking at the Nigerian refineries on this segment. Now, we also have Bala Zakka with us in the studio discussing this. Now, let's give you some basic information here. Nigeria had 4 main oil refineries, but with the major 2 in oil-rich Port Harcourt, there are now 3. The other 2 in Kaduna and Warri.
The Port Harcourt refinery has a total capacity of 10.5 million metric tons per year. The Kaduna refinery, 5.5 million, and the capacity of that in Warri is 6.2 million metric tons per year. Now, together, the refineries have a collective capacity of 445,000 barrels per day, but currently operate below 40% capacity.
Now, since the return to democracy in 1999, the government has expended 264 billion naira on maintenance of the refineries. But the billions don't seem to have done much. Maintenance of the refineries is one of the core issues surrounding the lack of a satisfactory output in the Nigerian oil industry.
Yet efforts have been made to encourage private investors to build refineries, but that too hasn't been as fruitful as planned. In 2002, 18 licenses were granted investors, and as at today, only one of them has come on stream with just 1,000 barrels per day capacity. Businessman Aliko Dangote is currently building a 650,000 barrel per day capacity refinery on the outskirts of Lagos.
And that project is expected to be completed in 2019. Before that, he had won the right to buy two of Nigeria's refineries. They were sold to him by the regime of former President Olusegun Obasanjo, but the deal was reversed by Obasanjo's successor, Umar Musa Yar'Adua. The refining of crude oil and other petroleum products translates into an economic boost and development for any nation.
And more worrisome is the fact that the importation of refined petroleum products puts a strain on foreign exchange. We're told Nigeria spends about $30 billion every year. That's in dollars, $30 billion in importing petroleum products. Now, this means the country's forex request for imports of petroleum products, which currently stands at 35%, will further increase in the coming months unless something is done about the state of the refinery. So the question is, should we privatize or put the ones we have in order and refine? Is that what is the way out, really? So that it seems to be a vicious cycle here.
The worst we can do to the refineries is to have them commercialized or liberalized. And back, let me be specific about Dangote now. Mm-hmm. You see, it's really shameful that a nation as big as Nigeria will be depending on an individual, a private individual, to bail it out. Why do we reason like this? Why? What if tomorrow Dangote decides that he wants to sell his refinery to somebody else? How can a nation depend on an individual, a private individual, to bail it out? A nation of close to 180 million people. Let me go straight to some of this point. You see, it's why not ask the question? If we had visionary leaders who between 1965 and 1989, in 25 years, they were able to construct four refineries with a nameplate capacity of 445,000 barrels, what is happening to the current crop of leaders, of leaders that have been there from 1990 to date? 26 years, they've not been able to construct one refinery.
And could not maintain
Maintain. Everybody knows that when you talk about refinery, it's just a basic principle of fractional distillation. It's basic chemistry. All you need are fractionating towers, you need boilers, you need trays, and you wait on temperature differentials.
Well, the point is, it's not even a question of capacity, because you have all kinds of refineries everywhere.
No, we're not talking about illegal refineries. We're not talking about illegal refineries based on stolen crude.
The capacity is there. You have, though it's crude knowledge,
yes,
but we're not taking advantage of this in a way,
we don't want to encourage,
to actually refine those people in terms of their skills.
When you talk about illegal refineries, you are talking about pollution plants. These are toxification plants and carcinogenic plants. If we want to talk about the effect they have on environmental degradation, that's a different thing. But I just want to tell you the extent to which the current generation of Nigerian leaders are trying to reduce Nigeria to a country of melancholy. If you speak to people today, they will tell you that the requirement of Nigerian consumption PMS is about 40 million liters. I am bluntly and crudely saying it's a lie. That value of 40 million liters, let me tell you how we arrive at it. You see, it's an insult. I'm really not happy that for the first time I'm talking as somebody who is very, very unhappy and upset on air that is beamed to the entire world. This is how we arrived at the 40 million barrels that people are carrying today, including leaders that you will be shocked hearing them talking about. The four refineries that we have been having, as at 1989, based on the nameplate capacity of 445,000 barrels, if you multiply that by 42, it will give you 18.6 million gallons, because one barrel is equal to 42 gallons.
Yes.
Then when you convert the gallons to liters, you will multiply the 18.6 million gallons by 4. If you multiply it by 4, it will give you about 76 74.6 million liters. So the general assumption is during refining, right, the yield for PMS, which is petrol, is between 50 and 60%, 70%. So if you assume it is about 60% yield, that is what you will get from crude. Exactly. And you multiply that by, the about 74.7 million liters, it will give you 44 million liters of petrol. Then when you assume that the refineries would work at like 90% capacity, and you multiply that 44 million liters by 0.9, it will give you about 40.3 million liters. So as at 1990, that was the estimate of the four refineries. When you refine them using a yield of 60%, but dear, be honest to ourselves, from 1990 to now, the number of Nigerians have increased. The number of cars have increased. The number of generators have increased. And we know that we don't have electricity again like before, because the Kainji Dam, the Shiroro Dam, the Jeba Dam are not contributing much again to the national grid. That's one. We also know that there are three sectors when you talk about economy development. You talk about strategic domestic sector, strategic industrial sector, and strategic commercial sector. Because of time, I wouldn't want to break down and say all these today are running on generators that depend on either petrol and diesel.
So the, how can somebody the estimate of 40 million is far below what we're actually using.
Great leaders in Nigeria saying some analysts
that
on its own is a shame and an indictment.
But, all right, now we don't have all the time though. But the, if we have to move forward, because we just have about a minute now, our producer is talking to us. What
the solution is simple. Internal domestication is the key forward. The biggest mistake you will do is for anybody, whether an economist or a Harvard graduate or a Cambridge graduate, to tell you that an economy like Nigeria should be deregulated. That will be the biggest mistake. Just like some people who knew that we are probably a 100% importing country and we're pushing Nigeria to devaluate its currency. Now we've seen the consequences. When some of us were saying, do not deregulate, some people said diesel was deregulated and diesel price was stable. We have seen the consequences now. All we need to do is we internally domesticate, get this crude oil from the wellheads in Naira, move them to the refineries, fix your refineries in Naira, refine them in Naira, distribute them in Naira, free yourself from exchange rate differentials. Then the next thing you do again, you look at the sub-region. Only supplying the sub-region, you become a hub for distribution of petroleum products, and you will be okay. Then in terms of gas, all you need, you talk about electricity. It is, they are supposed to be driven by gas also, all the stations.
But there are external factors or forces that will not allow you to denominate it. It's a lie.
These are the things. There was a time.
Some will cite the Gaddafi and the people like...
You see, it's just like there was a time we were being made to understand that it was the governors were complaining that it was because they were suffering from the hangover of the military. That was why they were not progressing. They couldn't carry up. And I said, are you telling me if I become a local government chairman, one retired captain or one retired major will come to my office and decide where I'm going to construct roads or hospital? These were lies.
Okay. That's another matter. Now, some are already putting the blame on the doorsteps of NNPC. You know, that's deviated from its original mandate of refining, for example, you know, treating and generally handling petroleum for manufacturing and production of petroleum products to marketing. NNPC is now involved in marketing and imports.
NNPC
and all
is
of that.
Just one of the institutions. NNPC, the managing directors and everybody take directives. If NNPC is giving the marching order today, if the government of Nigeria or if political leaders or even the present dispensation said in 4 years we will build one refinery, they can do it. Because they've decided that they want to bring back toll gates. Can you stop it? If they decide today that there must be local government, you can't stop it.
So political will is
it's
needed.
Just the will.
Political will that is lacking from 1999 to date. If we have decided that in just 4 years or one refinery in 8 years, we'll have been having how many? Two brand new refineries.
Do we know what it's costing? It's costing Nigeria really to continually import fuel, petrol.
We definitely
know. As far as economy
know.
Is concerned.
But the
generally.
Only reason is we have decided to allow economic marauders and political and economic vampires to decide how this country is going to be directed. But let me tell you, that and the non-passage of the PIB has honestly reduced Nigeria to a country of ridicule, because international or foreign airlines now land in your country. You are the biggest producer of crude oil, but they will need to go to smaller countries around you to fuel before moving to your respective
destination.
Is that
dangerous.
Not an
well, we
song?
Hear that the Port Harcourt refinery may soon begin to produce aviation fuel. Hopefully,
there
that
is
happens
nothing.
Soon.
We have what it takes. We have more engineers now. We have more oil and gas accountants now. We have more oil and gas environmentalists.
All right,
if
Bala
you Zakka. To do that is an indictment on the current leaders in Nigeria.
All right, Bala Zakka, thank you very much for enlightening us. Every time it's very provoking sometimes to hear some of these figures
that,
and
that
all of that.
We are the biggest, the most populous, and probably the most educated black nation on this earth, within the universe. And little things like this cannot be done.
All right, Bala, thank you very much for coming.
It affects your public and private persona.
Indeed.
Thanks for coming on the program this morning.
Okay.
Thank you.